Hey everybody, welcome to Make Your Show Story Evolution. We are so excited to have stage and screenwriter Jennifer Peterman and veteran actor Tony Head here to bring Jen's piece, Babe, to life. And we want to get going and have Tony read the piece. And then afterwards, we're going to give a little back and forth about how the piece might translate into an on-camera story. Jen, why don't you tell us a little bit about how Babe came to be and what its history has been till now?
Well, I'm a New York City waitress, about longer than would seem understandable, but about 10 years ago, I waited on a couple. I work in a steakhouse, and they were sitting at the worst table in the house. And they occupied this table for about 3 hours, and they, you know, they stuck out like sore thumbs. They weren't New Yorkers. They were deep Southern drawls, and they were in the middle of something which just seemed so harrowing. They were holding each other's hands, and the specificity of what they looked like and what they sounded like, her jewelry, his, you know, he took off this hospital bracelet and left it on the table, and he was drinking Bud Long Necks and lining them up on the table and wouldn't let me remove them. So, you know, one after the other, after 3 hours, there's 8 Bud Long Necks on the table. And I'm like, who are these people? And what are they going through? And after a 3 hour time with them, you know, the wife looks at me and they took interest in me and they were sweet and kind. And, you know, when you catch snippets of those conversations and all those specificities of their situation or their story, you know, my heart just kind of opened for them, and they were so dear and kind. And I thought to myself, I don't know what they're going through, but it's something pretty deep. And the wife looked at me and she said, you know, you must be an actress or a dancer or something, because you're too pretty and kind to be a waitress. And I get emotional about them. So he came out of that. He came out of, you know, what were they going through, and why the hospital, and why the Bud Long Necks, and what's all that turquoise mean? And, you know, I sat down and just started daydreaming about who he was and what he was going through.
I love that. It's incredible how a moment like that can inspire this.
And they were in this little bubble all to themselves. And when I tell you it was the worst table in the house, they just were wrapped in this protection with each other. It was really very, very dear.
Oh my gosh, that description is beautiful. And so is your piece.
Thank you.
So I think, are we ready?
Sure, okay. Let's go ahead and have Tony read Babe.
We hear a Connie Francis tune fade into the sound of a raucous bar, hooting and hollering, a crash of breaking glass, lights up on Babe, sitting at a bar, putting out a cigarette, opening a beer. He yells across the room.
No.
God, are you shitting me? Burn that ass now. People don't want cutters in their drink. Now, I'm not coming over there to tell you how to do your damn job. You don't want me to sick my wife on you, do you? I didn't think so. I like that kid. He's jittery. Well, I'd offer you some Duke, but you like that hydro hornet crap with all that blue hair, and I'm not getting up to light my guitar on fire. I just want to ease the pain zone. You know what's fun about being a dying man? You stop giving a shit, man. Things you couldn't even imagine. Now, I haven't clipped my toenails in several weeks now. Wife got the drunk again. She said she'd keep throwing in my casket for me to take to the afterlife. Look here. So I'm changing the kids with cotton, and look what I found. I met the wife score this way last year. I thought basically picked clean. Well, look at this. I about fall off my chair. I scanned the walls in the back. There are no pictures of this night. That's him in 1952. I think with Jimmy Day there, and that's my daddy. No, I was too young, but I remember daddy used to come home and say, there's this kid that played, he was gonna be something else. That's not New Year's Eve. It's fucking Elvis. Holy shit. Well, now I know how to get Snake Atkinson's guitar back on my wall. Look at this. Plain as day. Now, Snake's Gibson was hanging behind the drum set. Next morning, it wasn't. Look who was booked that week. Sleazy fucker. Never had him back. Took advantage of my good graces and the fact that I was shit-faced. Yeah, you're right. You all right. Duke, the cars are just not more kind to me when I have whiskey. Still gonna make that phone call. Ronnie Hawkins, Bonnie Ridge. There's a guy. How did the Texas Air Force in July? I tell you what. No, please don't tell me that. I just told you not to tell me that. I'm a married man, devoted. And you should be ashamed of yourself. How was she? You know, I was a bad person, dude. I did some bad things. Real bad. That one little feeling that same hand just about killed all I love. Crazy bitch. My dying advice to you. Don't fuck the crazy ones. They'll ruin you. Johnny Cash and me. Good man. Did me one of the best favors of my life. She's standing right over there, yelling at Cock. Honey, you want to grab those folks by the door and get me the number for steel management? Yeah, you can leave it by the phone. I finally get to yell at that asshole for good reason. Gonna get my guitar back. There's your boy. You remember that night? Stevie Ray came in here and blew the roof off the house. Only man I knew that could drink me under the table. Whatever else he did was too dark for me. Seeing him try to escape his God-given self, it was painful. I don't know what changes in a man to get right, but he did it. He did it. Then what? He crashes into the side of a fucking mountain. The good Lord needed one of the greatest guitar players in the world. Real quick. I ask you, is that fair? Not to me. To God, yes. So it's forgiven. Tell me it's forgiven. That's going to be my first question to St. Peter. Where's Stevie Ray at? My second question is, where the bar at? You see this fella here? His name is Folks. Now, he custom built this bar by hand, most likely with a gun to his head. He owed Pap some money. And this trap door down here was built for the bartender to escape. Yep. This little feature here, you need a gun at the ready, you flip these open, you shoot your shot. There's six of them, all built down this rail. Smokes was smart. You could tell he built this stand as if his life depended on it, because he did. The story goes that he bid for his life in trade. Now, I know how he felt. A prettiest jewel, ain't she? That is a 1938 Model 600 Wurlitzer. The Peacock, one at 4 a.m. last call. Up pops the Jack of Clubs. I got myself straight flush. That's a good hand. I don't get those too often. This big city dipshit came in here one night. After an auction, he offered me a bundle. I said, you sell me your wife, I'll sell you yours. I'll sell you my wife. I discovered over the years, that juke is my voice when I have nothing to say, when I can't say. Now, I bought in this fucking mechanical bull back in the 80s. Then I ripped it out right quick. There was more trouble over that fucking thing than I could tell you. It was cursed. That thing cost me an arm and a leg and repairs, not to mention the bar fights. Women should not ride a cab. The slower the speed, the more dangerous it is. Period. I sold it to this guy a few years back. He put it in his place and it killed him. Nah, it didn't buckle me up. His woman was riding the thing. Well, you know, she created a scene. Curse, I tell you. Now, you're going to come in my house. You're going to have a good goddamn time. You look around, it's going to be dancing, drinking, laughing. Well, Cotton looks a little bit upset over there. That's because Left just tore him a new one. Well, he's going to be all right. She's going to give him a big fat kiss and slap on his ass. I can't stand a hang dog in my bar. I can't stand trouble. Now, someone would say the trouble with trouble is that it starts out like fun until fun changes the rule mid-dance. I don't know who said it. It sounds true enough. Maybe I said it. Now, dude, this is my whole life here. This is something I own and put my back into. You know, I'm loyal to it because it's family first. My granddaddy, then my daddy, now me. I'm not telling you something. I'm third generation, just mean I was next in line for it. I couldn't do nothing else, really. But what I didn't expect was the history, the ghosts. Wife taught me about all that stuff. Pieces of people, reminders, pictures, songs, stories. So all the men in my family, they built this place right. I wanted to leave it to my nephew because he loves it. You know, he works hard, but he got bigger things. Nell, she twists it up tighter than a rancher's knot, but I think she gets it. She understands the gift of this place. Folks here, they rely on her. It's no use getting all hang dog about something you can't control. And trust me, no one anywhere wants to hear you bitch. Good Lord has a plan. Now, you pay attention to that plan, there's no reason you can't laugh your way all the way up to St. Peter. Now, I'm talking as a dying man. It's funny. I mean, this is good news as far as I'm concerned. I knew 3 years ago I only had a year. So good Lord tacked on a couple of extras so I could take care of things. Have a little bit more fun. Figure out all the why me shit. Why me? Why me? Because that's why. Now, I didn't think Anel would be able to pick up running this place in a year. Hell, it took it just a week to figure out how to keep the book. Another week to schedule the acts, so old cheap. She already owns the place. She's gonna learn to run it. That's all she gotta do. Just learn to run it without me. She'll be all right. Honey, why don't you hop up there and sing one of those songs for me? She said D7. D7, that's Connie Francis on the Duke. Every time I ask her to sing, she put on D7. She used to sing all the time, and she won't do it now. You should hear it, though. I don't care. She should sing. She just being a pain in the ass. She just wanted her way is all. She never loses sight of me. Or me. That's smart. See these keys here? These keys open every lock in this place. the two most important, this one, the cash register, and this one, the liquor room. You know what her biggest concern was? Toilet paper. I didn't get it. I thought, women are fucking batshit. Then it dawned on me, details. She's paying attention to the details, making people comfortable. How am I supposed to know how much toilet paper they go through? You walk into my utility room back then, you have your answer. I would take a bullet for her. Have to. In fact, I asked her to shoot me on the regular. It would be quicker. She said, I shoot you out, going to blazes, you get all the free tail in hell. Forget it. You want to check out? You come to me. So I'm going out slow. Apparently. It don't hurt. It just makes you tired. Sick as hell. I know I look shot at and missed and shit on in here. I never was looking. Nell wants me in the hospital bed hooked up to wires and tubes. I did that years ago. It was no fun at all. There was no whiskey in the hospital, no music, there were no friends. There was no storytelling. No jokes. She had it. I have my way now. Anil, you get that number, honey? No, just leave it be. I told you, darling, it's important to me. Yes, I'm almost done. You know what? I'm fixing to get her to sing again. All I've done. All I missed them. All I took. I can plead and I can beg. She just played D7, D7, D7. I know down deep, once I go, she's gonna stand up there like a mountain. She's gonna sing that song. She's gonna sing that fucking song. She'll be madder than a hornet that I ain't here. She's gonna buck. She's gonna cry, and she's gonna drink my best whiskey, probably get drunk on it, and she'll do it. I'm gonna write this down. I'm gonna seal it up. I want you to hold on to it. You mark my word. I'm coming back to my father, and I'm gonna haunt that woman. I'm gonna hold up in my juke. I'm gonna haunt her city. I don't want her to feel sorry for herself. I just want her to feel sorry.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my goodness, is right.
Oh my goodness.
Thank you.
That was beautiful.
That was so
beautiful.
Oh my goodness. I'm beside myself. Oh my goodness. Thank you so much.
I think Jen liked it.
I'm a crier.
Jennifer, it's such a beautiful piece. I mean, it's so rich. It's so rich in the and what's happening in that little piece of real estate at that particular time with those people. I really enjoyed reading it. It's wonderful.
Thank you so much. I've never heard him alive. I never heard him alive. It's amazing. It's amazing. I'm so moved. Thank you so much. Oh my goodness. I'm overwhelmed.
Yeah, there's so much drama, but comedy in it. It's all just sort of perfectly woven together that way, emotionally, I think. We know how it feels after you've read it. Tony, we know how you felt reading it. So what we might just want to do is figure out how something that was primarily written for the stage might translate into something that we watch. I've certainly done it sometimes the hard way in my life. So we just wonder how you would see it. I know there are other characters that are mentioned in the piece. Do you see yourself building it out as a feature, or do you see it as a short film? Or if you've ever given any thought to it at all, as on camera?
Yeah, you know, I haven't. I only just imagined it as a stage piece. I imagined it as a one person show. Either myself, you know, it was written for myself to do, and the companion piece is his wife. But of course, there's a way to cast another character and put him in dialogue. You know, as I'm listening to it, I'm thinking, oh, let me move that chunk, let me cut that, let me move that around. That's more image-based. We can see that in pictures, we can see that in a set, we can see that in costume. You know, I think because I love him so much and his story is so rich, I like a big fat close-up on his face, smoking, drinking, and the minimal amount of set work that you can do for interior and mood and tone, that kind of thing.
Well, I'd have to say that just as an exercise, you know, what Jason and I do when people come to us and they say they have something that they want to make, they're talking on camera. And so sometimes those ideas or those pieces do start in the theater. So they're not designed to be filmed. Sometimes they're written to be filmed, and it still takes work to figure it out. So the fun brainstorm game is, if we were to film this piece, how would we do it? And of course, there's always the what people want to do, have car chases, you know, have a shootout in the hospital or the subway. Right. And there's the things that we can do when we're not David Fincher. So if we were working together to make this, I would say probably first off, the bar is a character in this piece. Yeah. How can we do it without a bar? I would say Jason and I would normally suggest to a writer, if you're going to write something that you want to film, start out by thinking, of course, you have your stories and you have your characters, mm-hmm. but you have to think about where you have access to film. Right. So do you have a friend that runs a bar that can let you film that bar? Is that bar the right bar? You know, that's where I would start out, and the problem solving then begins. No, or maybe we could get one, but how do we work around only being able to be in there for 2 hours? Whatever those limitations are. So I think that'd be the first place I would start and thinking, okay, how can I tell this story if I don't have access to that bar? Right. That's a tough one, but I think it's totally possible, because then you're thinking again, if Jason said this is a short film, the main story is really about this character who's coming to the end of his life and trying to reconcile with the things that he's done. And kind of relive these stories. Where else could that happen?
It might prompt you. You know, so we've produced so much based on what locations we have in our back pocket.
And well, my brain just jumped to, well, you know, let's put him in the hospital bed. Let's make him a dying man, and let's have him be so drugged up and freaked out that he thinks he's in his goddamn bar.
That's a nice idea. I love that idea.
And it's, you know, it feels like it would be sterile. And then there's the part of me that's like, oh, but don't let go of the music and don't let go of the brick wall and the, you know, but for production purposes, I just want the character and the piece to stand on its own. So that's my first fat, you know, let go an idea.
I think that's a great possible idea. Again, no bad ideas in a brainstorm. The second one, again, just what we're talking about with Tony a second ago, is music licensing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love these characters. I love these musicians, but how could we film this without having to license their music?
Right.
Or show their images in the film, right? Because obviously we would see the pictures. I mean, one idea that Jason had was maybe we recreate his memories. That's a fun possibility.
Create fictional musicians who are of that same.
Fictional musicians, yeah.
Interesting, yeah, yeah.
Which then would allow you. Great musicians out there that aren't famous and could have music that you don't necessarily need to license, or you know, it could be a more affordable arrangement than right. Johnny Cash's estate.
Right. I mean, you can't use images of Elvis. You can't use images of Stevie Ray Vaughan.
So that's the question. What can you get away with and what can you not get away with? And if you don't want to hire a lawyer or, you know, do a lot of research,
play it safe.
How can you tell the same story? I mean, Babe had a relationship with Bonnie Raitt. You know, Johnny Cash introduced him to his wife. These are amazing stories with amazing people that are known the world round. But if you're going to film it yourself, is there a way you can tell his story without having those characters?
Sure.
Again, it would be part of the brainstorming process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would want to find that jukebox. That would
be right? Bad, but man. I mean, I love the idea of staying with the bar. I think because the bar is sort of the metaphor for Babe's life. And one thing John and I chatted about was the overall narrative of the piece and how it could stand on its own without having to build out like a feature film if you didn't want to do that sort of a thing, is in building a little more immediacy, like what if it's the last day of the bar? What if he's just finding these photos, which mm-hmm. will bring a different perspective for the character to just come across these things. And what if, you know, if he had all the money in the world, and maybe not even that much, if while he's looking at the photos, they come alive into footage, so that you could shoot some of this stuff with characters and maybe you make it sepia toned or something. Now you're talking about a visual world that is being created. While he could still be talking in voiceover, we could be seeing these things come to life. And maybe perhaps with a minimal budget. I mean, you're not talking about a hugely expensive thing to get some people to shoot something, maybe make it outside or against some location you have in your back pocket. To sort of bring a new perspective to the story.
Mm-hmm. I would say that when Jason and I work with people that, correct me if I'm wrong, Jason, but this is our favorite part of working with people is
always
playing with their incredible stories and trying to envision how we can make it happen. And I think a lot of times when people have these great ideas, it's hard for them to get to that next step, which is how do you make it? And of course, this is a theater piece, so there is that path, but this is a different path. And what are the potential hurdles that you have to overcome to make this thing happen? Jen, you were saying that the other thing that happens is that you get inspired. You have all these other stories. You have a piece for Anel. Can you tell us a little bit about that? Would that be something maybe that would be filmed on its own, or all of a sudden, is this a series instead of a short film? What's it making you think?
You know, I miss them terribly, so they're very relieved to be out and about. Like I said, it was written for me to do it personally, so I'm happy to let that go and give it to other actors and make them alive in a different way. Anel's story is very different. It's a different scenario altogether, but it still is, you know, death and dying, loss and redemption. That's actually, as I envision that, it's a more affordable adventure. She's sitting in the backseat of a limo, you know. So.
Well, again, I think one of the steps, if somebody does want to make something for a screen, whether that's a big screen, a little screen, mm-hmm. a digital screen, who knows these days, the fun is, what are people going to see, right? How am I going to tell this story in a visual way? So it's obviously very different from doing something in the theater, what you can do, how you can tell a story. So if we just stick with Babe and his story in this bar, there are a lot of different ways you can do it. And what we were talking about a second ago, it really reminds me of this book by Paul Auster. Should have looked it up before we talked, because it did pop into my head right before we were talking. I think it's called The Invention of Solitude. And anyway, the story is that his father has died suddenly and he's responsible for packing up the house. And instead of just photographs like Babe, Paul Auster is going through all these belongings of his father's and just exploring how we are our things sometimes, right? I mean, much of our lives, what is it that we identify with so strongly. I mean, Babe has a bar and a life in this bar that was three generations. That's something that most of us don't have, but he has all these items too that, you know, for me, the musical instruments are so fun, like the guitar, the drums, those things, the jukebox, and the key ring. So when you think about the difference between something on stage and something that would be filmed, is those things can become characters. You can have a close up of those things and watch those things have a life in certain ways. I mean, just the jukebox, the life of the jukebox. So there are just different possibilities, you know, for storytelling in that medium.
Yeah, I think there's this great opportunity with it. I like the idea of letting it stand on its own with all your text, with all of that beautiful stuff that you've written, and maybe just harnessing it in this. If you were to find the perfect bar, can he deliver a chunk of it behind the bar and then sitting there where a patron would sit? Is he in the liquor room? Is he in the bathroom for part of it? Like, to move it, to make it move.
Right.
And I really like, you know, is this his last confession? Is this his last day, not only at the bar, but of his life? Mm-hmm. And John had asked something earlier too, when we were chatting about it, like, is he thinking of taking his own life? Is he thinking of just getting to the end of it? Did that occur to you at all, Tony, while you were?
No, that particular thing did not occur to me, but it's all in coming to terms. You know, we all expect to die at some point. It's when people start telling you, you've got this much time left.
You know?
And then it becomes, I got an approximate date when I'm going down. Now everything is all out of whack. And you have to deal with that and coming to terms. But here he's outlived that term for 2 years. Yeah. So now he's like in this, it's almost like he's in between what was expected of him to die, and he's still going. He doesn't know how long it could go, a day, it could go another 6 months. So he's in like a limbo in this in-between world. I think it opens it up for discussion as to how he chooses to finish this off. Mm-hmm. Does he choose to finish it off by just going buck wild and just doing the stuff he's always wanted to do? Or maybe does he feel that he owes Anel that time that he took away from her with all his indiscretions before? Is it makeup time now? You know, so these are the questions he has to ask himself, how he wants to spend this time. I don't think he's thinking about taking his life.
I never thought about that angle of him taking his own life, but Tony, that's beautiful that he's kind of in between. I mean, maybe he had a year and two got tacked on, and maybe he's thinking, you know what? I bet I can kick this thing. I got 2 years, and why not 4 more? Why not 10 more? You know, yeah. I think he's in his, I put him between 60 and 70.
Yeah. I mean, he doesn't know, you know, he doesn't know. I mean, but he says he was sick before, he was in the hospital, you know, so he knows he can get back to that, but not so much now. You know, he's just sick and tired now. So it's a lot of areas to explore there. A lot of areas.
Yeah. And another interesting possibility might be if Duke and Cotton and Anel, if all these people have already gone on, and he finds himself sort of imagining them, that they're still there, which might push him to, might push to some sort of ambiguous yet satisfying ending of the story, that maybe he's contemplating something or going.
Well, what about the twist? What about, we see that, and then at the end, we find out this was all his imagination, and he is in the hospital bed. And he just imagined all of those things. But
like he's getting ready.
And at the end, they come in and he dies, you know, because he just imagined all of this before he died. That would be wild.
Well, I think it does bring me back to what you were talking about a minute ago, Tony, which is, to me, I wonder, what is the main thing that Babe wants right now? These stories, these characters, this place is so rich and alive. But if there's a primary drive, what is it? And then you know, you mentioned the surprise twist at the end, right? So that's the arc of the story. Here we are. Today's the day. Why? We don't know. Is it because he found the pictures today? Is it because he's closing the bar today? And what is it that he wants to? It sounds like he's near the end potentially. So if there's one last thing he wants to do, it does sound like he wants forgiveness.
He wants redemption and forgiveness.
I was just going to say redemption.
Redemption. And I have to get more specific about it going back through, but he wants so badly to be forgiven and bring his wife back to where she was at in her career, in her singing career, that I think he makes the decision right in the moment to hole up in the jukebox and haunt her. Oh my God, I didn't think that this was a possibility. I get to haunt her. I can be a ghost. That's what I want to do. I want to come back as a ghost.
So his primary goal is to get his wife to sing again. That mm-hmm. is a sign that she's forgiven him.
Yep. And the only way he's going to do it is if he comes back as a ghost and he's holed up in the jukebox and he gets to, she presses D7 and she sings it. And he's like, good, at least I can pass yeah. over.
Because he's convinced that's the only way that she will sing is when he's
yep.
gone.
Yep.
You know, yeah. because she's not, because of all the things that he did, she's purposely not singing. She's not, she's playing D7. So when he goes, he knows that she is going to sing.
Right.
Is it clear that the infidelity is as grave as it is? I was trying to play with more specificity of his.
So it sounds, did he have an affair with Bonnie Raitt the way that it's written? It looks.
No, that's
there was another singer.
Yeah, there was another singer. And in my daydream about it, it was, you know, it almost ended their marriage. It was one of those women that was like a young Carrie Underwood, you know, like she was going to be this. She just came out swinging. Mm-hmm. And he was fostering her career because she was this young, pretty thing. And Annelle is a big, ugly woman. I mean, like a big Patsy Cline, like, you know, not attractive, but a voice like a brick shithouse, you know? Mm-hmm. So he paid more attention to lining his pockets and getting this Carrie Underwood-like creature to give him some fame too. And all the while, Annelle was like, are you shitting me? Like, so... that it wasn't just that infidelity, it was career. It was also career path.
Mm-hmm. Wow, now you've really made me want to see a feature film of this, this story.
Yeah, that is not a short film.
I know.
But that's, you know, that's always one of the first questions too. And none of the stuff is ever written in stone. Is it a short film? Is it a series? Is it a feature film? The story usually tells you as you write, it might change. As you film, it might change.
That's true.
In editing,
yeah, developing. I have a collaborator. We developed a series pilot, a drama that, you know, it took a good year to get the first draft, and then in the brainstorming process and the development process of a pilot into a season, into ongoing seasons, it was, you know, the mental energy of that.
Yeah,
it's fun as hell, but and then all of a sudden you're like, oh my gosh, this is, I don't see this as a series.
I was going to say is that if you've written these monologues and they live like that, that then your series could be a series of these monologues that you shoot in this way that might be consistent, or they might have a different tone and feel to them with each new character that you present, but they could all relate to each other so that you are getting sort of the backbone of a series without having to do the production and development that's required for a typical series. You can make it anything you want as long as the storyline is there.
Yeah.
And that's that's what I love about digital storytelling. It's very liberating. You can make it anything you want. It doesn't have to be what Hollywood or anyone else has said that a typical series generally is. And if this stuff is already in your computer, it might just take a tweak way of how you would produce the story to get it out there to the world, to make it.
Yeah, yeah. I like the idea of the simplicity. I like the idea of the storytelling, just the, you know, not, a friend of mine recommended these BBC sessions. I forget the title of it. I jotted it down. Anyway, so I like that simplicity also for production value, but I don't know how it's going to look. And as the writer, and I'm sure the actor is like, oh man, I don't want to give up Stevie Ray Vaughan. I don't want to give up Elvis. I can do that, but then it feels like I'm cheating a little bit, which is fine. It's just a big compromise to therapy.
You know, and I know it can seem that way, but then it might bring a happy accident. It might bring you into a place where if you were to take a character that's like Elvis and you create it yourself, maybe then you've created another part of your series and you have total agency over it. It's yours.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed.
Well, yeah. Guys, thank you so much, Jen. Thank you.
Thank you. Jen, thank you for sharing your work with us. And if you feel compelled to after ingesting all of this stuff, send more.
Oh my God, I'm over the moon. This has just been so enlightening and uplifting. Tony, you did him justice above and beyond what I could expect. I'm so grateful.
Sure. Jennifer, so grateful. Don't hesitate to reach out. For anything, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you're a creative person. I love your writing. It was,
thank you.
I mean, when I read through it a couple of times, I said, who is this person that's writing?
Oh,
you gotta be much older than what you are, because there's a soulfulness about the relationship between the two, Enel and Babe. And it's just a wonderfully written piece. Congratulations. It's really nice.
Thank you so much. It's so dear. All right, guys.
Okay, thanks.